A-Rod is back. Is LeBron James a Hall of Famer? Will Beast Mode return next season? Stay tuned, because you're about to get in the zone. Welcome to In The Zone. I'm your host for this afternoon. My name is Mark. I'm here with Mike and Alan. How you doing today, fellas?
What's going on, Mark? Good. Doing great. How are you?
I'm doing very well. Let's dig into it. All right. MLB's opening day is about 41 days away, and the Philadelphia Phillies ace, Cole Hamels, says he wants out. Guys, who are some teams that could be in the hunt for Cole Hamels? Mike?
Well, let me start by saying I don't think he's actually going to go anywhere. You know, Ruben Amaro really doesn't know what he's doing, to be quite honest, but if I had to pick one team that I think would be in contention, would be the Red Sox right now, just because of, and pardon me if I butcher this name, but Yoan Moncada, the Cuban prospect who everyone's been talking about, he's 19 years old, they just signed a deal with him. So I think that's going to give them a lot of prospects that they can work with now that they have this young phenom who they hope to come up through their system. They can somewhat dump some of their prospects, and it'll give them a lot of stock to try to get Cole Hamels. But I honestly don't think that he's going anywhere, and he will be a Philly at the start of the season.
Alan, what do you think?
Hey, so I pulled together a list of potential teams that Cole Hamels will give the utmost permission for Ruben Amaro Jr. to send him to. They're the Dodgers, the Angels, St. Louis, the Nats, Braves, Yankees, Boston Rangers, and San Diego. Being from suburban San Diego, just outside of the markets of the Angels, the Padres, the Dodgers, and the Oakland Athletics. Great area for him. Nice weather. Great for him to go home. So I included the Dodgers as well as the Cardinals as two of my teams that he could potentially go home to. For the Dodgers, obviously, it's from an area that he is accustomed to. He grew up around there. Big Mart team. He has said, quote, "I just want to win." The Dodgers acquisition of Jimmy Rollins, already having Clayton Kershaw, Yasiel Puig, and a lot of great supporting cast members could easily be in the contention for the National League pennant in the 2015 season. He has chemistry with former teammate Jimmy Rollins, and Ruben Amaro Jr. could easily bring back a package containing Jock Peterson, who in the 2014 season at AAA level, he hit 33 home runs and had a .303 batting average. That would be a great addition to the Philadelphia Phillies roster. And then for the reasons for the St. Louis Cardinals, his wife, got to play the family card, his wife has family in that area.
Okay.
And they have plenty of...
So Alan, you think it's good for him to go to the Dodgers? You agree with that?
I think it's good for him, and I think it's good for him. I think it's good for the Phillies. It'll easily benefit both sides.
All right, sounds good. Let's move on to our next one. A-Rod is back after missing a full season with allegations of doping. Will the former MVP returns to the Big Apple? Will Alex Rodriguez make any type of impact for the Yankees this upcoming season? Mike, what do you think?
I'm going to have to say no here. You know, like you said, he's been out of the league for over a year. I think he's going to be very rusty. He's shown that toward the end, before his suspension, he was very injury prone, which is a side effect of HGH and all these steroids allegations. So I think it'll be interesting to see. I think he will start off as a starter for the Yankees. He'll get his time, but I don't think that he's going to be able to produce just to the fact that he's getting old, his body's starting to deteriorate, and I think the Yankees are going to want to go with a more younger look for the future of their team. And I think that this is probably his last year as a Yankee.
All right, Alan, what do you think? Keep it brief.
I definitely agree. His slugging percentage has been going down every single year since 2008. He has not hit over 20 home runs since 2010. He's been going downhill. He could easily be a designated hitter. In the field, he's getting slower. His fielding percentage is going down. He's not the player that he was coveted to be from the Texas Rangers organization.
Okay.
They need to start moving past him.
Sounds good. You know what? Honestly, I personally think, I mean, if no disrespect to Big Poppy, but if he can play DH for the Red Sox, I don't see why Alex Rodriguez, the fifth all-time home run leader, can play DH for the New York Yankees. So that's just what I think.
I mean, I don't think he's going to be a Yankee next year just because of everything that's going on, but I wouldn't be surprised to see another AL team try to pick him up and have him be in that DH spot.
All right, sounds good, fellas. Let's move on. The Kentucky Wildcats have jumped off to the best start in program's history. They started off 27-0. They have a 6'9 front court. No one is taller than that. Now, do they have a legit chance at winning this year's NCAA Men's Basketball Champion? Alan, what do you think?
I think they have a legit shot, but I would not put my money on them yet. What I'm really looking on is defense. Right here, you got Kentucky going over Auburn 34-11 with just under 6:50 and a half in this game. Then they go to 48-24 against Auburn later in the first quarter. And they have a big lead going into the half and later on in this game. But I'm really looking at the Virginia Cavaliers that could easily out-defense them. They're allowing an NCAA low 50.5 points per game. That is impeccable in men's college basketball. That's someone that they really need to look out for later on in the men's national basketball tournament.
Okay, Mike, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I think that they're definitely dominating right now. It's pretty obvious, 27-0, obvious 1-seed. John Calipari knows what's going on. He knows how to use his guys to the best of their ability. Like Alan said, Virginia has a great defense, so I think that'll be a great matchup. We'll see how this immovable force, you know, the unstoppable object, you know, defense and offense meet. We'll see what happens, but a team hasn't gone undefeated to win the national championship since the 76 Hoosiers, coached by Bobby Knight, so history is not on Kentucky's side, and, you know, they have the chance, but there's always that hot team that can come in the tournament and upset them.
You know, I personally think that they might have a chance because they have 11 All-Americans. Like, these guys are the real deal. Like, I mean, they could beat the Sixers right now or the Knicks. You know, these guys are serious, and their front court is very athletic. So I wouldn't be surprised if these guys did go on the rest of the season undefeated and shock the world. So, I mean, Kentucky's one of the great prestigious programs in the NCAA, so I think they can pull it off. Now let's jump on to the next one. It's finally going down. After many years of anticipation, we will finally get a chance to see Floyd Money Mayweather versus Manny Pacquiao May 2nd in Las Vegas. Man, who are you guys coming out as the victor? I'm taking Money May. Alan, what do you think?
I'm going with Money Mayweather. It's going to make Pac-Man look like a blinking blue ghost.
Oh, wow.
This is the man that is undefeated. Majority of his fights have either come under technical knockout or straight-out knockout. This is a man that has defeated, you could say it's scripted, you could say whatever it is, but this man legitimately knocked out, has been said in interviews and in many post-fight type of shows. This man has knocked out Big Show, a.k.a. Paul White,
former wrestling
champion, and he was also training to be a professional boxer.
No.
This man was over 400 pounds.
I'm
going
to have to take the opposite here. I think Pacquiao comes out with the win.
Ooh.
He's got 10 more fights under his belt, 10 more knockouts. Ooh. I think he's going to make Money Mayweather put his money where his mouth is and finally shut him up and give him his first loss.
Wow. Ooh. Wow. Unbelievable. I can't believe you just said that. So, stay tuned. We'll be back. We have to run to a commercial break. You're in the zone.
See, son, good manners are important. Should I go through it again?
Yes.
Please.
Yes, please.
Exactly. Always say please, thank you, you're welcome, excuse me, sit up straight, hold doors open for ladies, the doors locked, knock first, don't burp, don't swear, don't stare, don't use bad language, or talk with your mouth full, keep your elbows off the table.
What table?
And don't interrupt. Cover your mouth when you cough or sneeze. On the bus, give your seat up to anybody who has trouble standing. Bottom line, treat others the way you want to be treated. Got it?
Got it.
Good talk.
Most parenting is hard to do in just 2 minutes. But 2 minutes twice a day making sure they brush is easier, and it could help save them from a lifetime of tooth pain.
Things that can keep us safe. Those we use all the time with hardly a thought. Those that are silently standing by to save our lives. And now, those that we carry with us everywhere we go. Many mobile devices will now bring you wireless emergency alerts, real-time information directly from local sources you know and trust. With a unique sound and vibration, you'll be in the know wherever you are.
For authentic Italian dining, go to Nino's Pizzeria. Nino's menu includes pizza, wings, stromboli, subs, and Italian dinners. Stop by from 10 to 2 on weekdays for the lunch special. Nino's Pizzeria, 11 Manor Ave, Millersville.
Don't let salmonella get funky with your chicken. On average, 1 in 6 Americans will get a foodborne illness this year. So learn the right temperature to cook each type of meat. Keep your family safe at foodsafety.gov.
Welcome back to In the Zone. All right, let's get started with our second segment. All right, NBA, of course. The NBA trade deadline has come and gone. Who do you guys have the winner and losers? And who can make a real chance at making the playoffs this season? Alan, what do you think?
My winner, the Philadelphia 76ers. They
Wait. You said winner?
Yeah,
okay.
Winner. They're extremely helping their chances as being a big-time contender in upcoming seasons. For example, you got Isaiah Cannon stepping up and filling the void offensively and filling in where they lose Michael Carter Williams. Michael Carter Williams was shooting in the 20 percentile from the field goal range, any kind of field goal range, from two-pointers and a whole
Alan,
lot
you
worse
think
three-pointers.
Trading away the rookie, the former rookie of the year, is a win? Just to rebuild, to get a first round pick that might not even be a number one pick. Well, it could be Anthony Davis or Kwame Brown. It's all about luck. This is terrible.
I felt the same way, but then I looked at his stats, and Isaiah Cannon looks a few steps above him, and they're about the same age. And plus, they also got JaVale McGee,
JaVale McGee.
He's a terrific backup behind Miles.
I mean, I have Portland winning this trade deadline. You know, they had a big pickup with Aaron Aflalo. You know, he wasn't doing too great in Denver coming off the starting, but now with Portland, he will be probably coming off the bench, and I think he can be a great asset for them as a bench player. And with Damian Lillard and LaMarcus Aldridge, they're two guys that I think that can set up his game really well, and that'll be a nice fit for him, and he could definitely give them that extra oomph that they need to make a run.
I think the winners of the deadline is actually the Thunder, with that trading away Reggie Jackson, who didn't want to be there, a.k.a. Bobby Shmurda. Traded him away to the Pistons. They get back Kyle Singler, and also before earlier in the season, they got Deion Waiters. So they loaded up a lot, and they also picked up Enes Kanter from Utah. He was huge, getting rid of Kendrick Perkins, who's just taking up space in the lane and just eating up all that money. So I'd say the winners are definitely the Oklahoma City Thunder and the losers, the Philadelphia 76ers. So let's move on to our next one. Yesterday, LeBron James passed Allen Iverson for number 22 on the all-time scoring list. Is LeBron James, if LeBron James was to hang it up today, Would he be considered a Hall of Fame, Mike? Hall of Famer, Mike?
Absolutely.
What do you think?
Absolutely. I don't know how you can say no to this. LeBron, he's arguably the face of American sports today. Everybody knows who LeBron James is. He's a two-time Finals champion. He's a four-time MVP, an 11-time All-Star, and you know that he's going to get at least one more championship and maybe at least one more MVP award before his career is over. I just think that he is the face of not only basketball but American sports. There's no way that he won't be a first ballot Hall of Famer.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. Alan, what do you think?
I believe he's a Hall of Famer, but not quite yet. He has tremendous field goal and three-point shooting percentages as well as from the line, but he really needs to work on his assists and be a better team player as well as his steals and make better defense into offense type plays.
Oh man, I'm sorry, but I think LeBron James is on pace to be one of the first players to ever score 30,000 points, grab 10,000 rebounds and have 10,000 assists. So LeBron will definitely be in the Hall of Fame with his four MVPs, his two rings, and a gold medal, of course. So LeBron, hands down, if he hangs it up today, he's making the Hall of Fame. So let's move on to the next one. With the second half of the season underway, Kevin Durant is sidelined with a foot procedure. The OKC Thunder currently hold the eighth seed in the Western Conference. Will they be able to hold on to the eighth seed without Kevin Durant, the former MVP? Mike, what do you think?
You know, I'm going to piggyback off what you said about the trade deadline. They had a great trade deadline. They made some good acquisitions for their bench, you know, some good side guys and role players that I think can help out this team. And Russell Westbrook is an absolute monster. I think that they definitely will get the eighth seed. They're going to be in the playoffs, and look for them to make a run when Kevin Durant gets healthy.
I agree. Alan, what do you think?
I'm going to have to agree as well. Their trades and acquisitions at the trade line deadline will definitely benefit them. Kevin Durant, 25 points a game he's averaging right now. That will help them even more when they get to the playoffs.
I agree. Also, Russell Westbrook is a beast. I mean, like Kobe said in the interview, he has heart. So Russell Westbrook is my guy, and he just won't stop. You saw in the All-Star game when it's all fun and games, and he just keeps going. There's nothing you can do with Russell Westbrook. He is the man. He's lights out. But they will definitely hold on without Kevin Durant. I mean, not to say that they'll make it to the championship or maybe win a championship without Kevin Durant, but they will definitely make steps. Like I mentioned earlier, they have Kyle Singler and Enes Kanter, and they also added depth to their bench, which is something that they were lacking when the season started. So I think they'll be fine, and they'll hold on.
Yeah, it's going to be tough to make a finals run with Durant, but I think they'll get that eighth seed. You know, they'll sneak in there. They'll be able to at least maybe get a first-round win, but we'll see, depending on his health.
Hey, if they get that eighth seed, be ready. It's going to be Golden State and OKC. That's going to
be
nice to watch
series
in the first round. All right. Pelican star Anthony Davis will be out for 1 to 2 weeks with a shoulder injury. New Orleans currently are 28-27. And are two games out of the Western Conference playoffs. Will they sneak into the playoffs, or will they be left out? Mike, what do you think?
Yeah, I think they're going to be on the outside looking in on this one. Like we were just talking about the Thunder, I think they are going to make it in over the Pelicans. Anthony Davis is the centerpiece, but he is also young. He's got 1 to 2 weeks, like you said. It's not that long of an injury, but I just don't think that they have what it takes to support him and to get to that eighth seed and make it into the playoffs. But they have a lot of potential for years to come. Anthony Davis is, what, only 21, 22 years old? So he's got a great career ahead of him, so I don't think they're going to rush anything. But look for them to make a couple runs in years to come.
What do you think, Alan?
I agree they're going to be on the outside looking in just because teams like the Sixers have potential. The lonely Sixers have potential to beat the Pelicans just like they did earlier in the year during their first meeting of the season. The Sixers beat the Pelicans. And when a team like the lonely Sixers can beat you when your star player is out and he is currently out, you will have a lot of ground to make up at the end of the season, and that will be way too much ground for them to make up to even get close to the playoffs.
Alan, I'm convinced you're a diehard Sixers fan. You can't keep them out of your mouth, man. You think they couldn't beat the Pelicans right now if they tried? Tyreke Evans, who's currently playing point guard for the Pelicans, would light them up. So I don't, but just to jump back on, I don't think the Pelicans have a chance of making it. The Thunder will take off, and 2 weeks is a long time in the Western Conference. So that's definitely a lot to lose. They lost Drew Holiday earlier in the season, so they've definitely been struggling a lot. So we'll see exactly what happens. But yeah, Allen, you gotta let go of the Sixers, man. I'm sorry, I gotta mention that one more time. But listen, guys, that was it for our second segment. Stay tuned, but we'll be right back after commercial break. Am I band about that money? Break it down. Girls hit you, hallelujah. Girls hit you, hallelujah. Girls hit you, hallelujah. Cause Uptown Funk don't give it to you. Cause Uptown Funk don't give it to you. Cause Uptown Funk don't give it to you. Saturday night and we in the spot. And you dig it, just watch.
Starting in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Don't believe me, just watch.
So you see, son, good manners are important. Should I go through it again?
Yes.
Yes, please.
Yes, please.
Exactly. Always say please, thank you, you're welcome, excuse me, sit up straight, hold doors open for ladies, if the door's locked, knock first, don't burp, don't swear, don't stare, don't use bad language, or talk with your mouth full, keep your elbows off the table.
What table?
And don't interrupt. Cover your mouth when you cough or sneeze. On the bus, give your seat up to anybody who has trouble standing. Bottom line, treat others the way you want to be treated. Got it?
Got it.
Good talk.
Most parenting is hard to do in just 2 minutes. But 2 minutes twice a day making sure they brush is easier, and it could help save them from a lifetime of tooth pain.
The Snapper, home of the latest local news, sports, and entertainment. There's something for everyone. Under completely new management, The Snapper is back on track, run entirely by our student staff. Interested in being a writer? Applications can be sent to thesnapper.com/apply. Join us in Hash 161 every Thursday at 9 p.m. and don't forget to pick up your copy of The Snapper every Thursday. The Snapper, Millersville University's student newspaper since 1925.
91.7 FM WIXQ, Millersville's number one music source, the university's student-run radio station. Tune in daily to hear a variety of music beyond the top 40s. Want to be a DJ? All majors are welcome. Email operationsmanager@wixq.com for more information. Visit us online at wixq.com. 91.7 FM WIXQ, your number one music source.
There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit theshelterpetproject.org. Adopt.
I need a card reader for like 3 minutes.
All right. Do you have your ID?
I'm in the editing room right down the hall.
Without having your ID, there's nothing I can really do for you.
But I have it there.
Kevin for a couple weeks. Thanks.
No problem. Do you need anything else?
No, I'm good. Thank you.
All right. What?
Welcome back to In the Zone. We are now in our third and final segment, so let's dig right into it. So the NFL Combine to start. Fellas, who were you impressed with, Marcus Mariota or Jameis Winston?
I'm going to have to go with Marcus Mariota on this one. I think in a lot of the events, if you want to call them, Mariota had better performance. You know, he ran a 4.52 40, almost half a second better than Winston. But I think it'll be interesting to see which one performs better come their rookie year. I think they both have the potential to be starting quarterbacks this year. Wow. We'll see who they end up with, but it also depends on the team that they're with and the system that they're performing in.
Wow, Jameis Winston looks so slow right there. It looks like he's been eating a bunch of crab legs. Allen, what do you think?
Yeah, it looked like, from what we just showed, Marcus Mariota was about 4 or 5 body lengths ahead of Jameis Winston. He was quicker, faster release on one of the drills. He had about a foot or so longer leap for the dash. He had a quicker release, and it looked like he can throw a little bit farther too, but it goes all down to the scheme of what coach he has when he goes to his team for the draft. You can't base everything off the combine. Guys like Tom Brady really proved that. Really, really slow when it comes to dash time.
Okay.
Amazing player.
All right, let me throw you a curveball. How do you guys feel about the Philadelphia Eagles jumping up in the draft to potentially grab Marcus Mariota. Mike, what do you think?
I think 100% you should do the deal, as Sal Powell was saying. You're going nowhere with Nick Foles. He's not what you need in Chip Kelly's system. Chip Kelly recruited this guy. He knows him well. It'll be a great fit for Mariota, and I just think that if you want to make that Super Bowl run, which the Eagles haven't shown they have the potential to do, you need to roll the dice and you need to make a big move, or else you're just going to be stuck in mediocrity like they have been as of late.
Now, my question is this. Who would they possibly trade to jump up? I mean, the only person we have of value is Shady McCoy. You get rid of Shady McCoy to get Marcus Mariota?
I don't think they're going to have to, just because of the fact that Mariota is in the Oregon system, which is a system that only Chip Kelly seems to run in the NFL. A lot of teams don't run that system that he succeeds in. So I think that that could hurt his stock a little bit, because these guys are going to see that he might not be the best fit for their team. So mm-hmm. he's going to slide. And if he can slide to maybe 9 or 10, then they can definitely make a deal without having to sell the farm.
That's going to be very interesting. Alan, what do you think?
You also got to remember, draft, you can also ship out a lot of draft picks too. So you might not have to send away Shady. You could send away a backup tight end. You can send away a backup blocking type fullback, running back. You could put in Chris Polk, who seemed to be very impressive towards the end of the year. Some poke-in type third down plays with goal line. You could throw in a Brad Smith, if he's still on the roster, type receiver package, him in with some draft picks.
Alan, that all sounds pretty good, but who would really take those guys? They're backups. We don't really know how much they can actually produce. So, I mean, hey, only time will tell. So, you know, I always wish the best for my Philadelphia Eagles. But, hey, let's jump into it. Will Marshawn Lynch, a.k.a. Beast Mode, retire this upcoming season? There are rumors saying that he might retire. What do you guys think? I mean, if I was him, I might retire after not handing me the ball on the one-yard line in the Super Bowl, but that's none of my business. Alan, go ahead. What do you think?
Well, we've had some legendary-type players like Jerome Bettis take the money and run, take the trophy and run, I'll say, at the Super Bowl 40. But Marshawn Lynch has a history of holding out for the big money contract, just like last year's training camp. Pete Carroll had to convince him to report to camp. And I could easily see him doing that the same thing this year as well. This is a man that is very, very strong to what he believes in. He only shows up to press conferences so he doesn't get fined. So he might just show up to training camp so he does not get fined. This is a man I could easily just say, hey, I'm going to take my Skittles endorsement, jump on top of a NASCAR car in the middle of the track, say, hey, gentlemen, start your engines. I'm going to take my sponsorship money. I'm going to get out of here, stop here and hurt. I'm just going to sit home, watch the game at home, because this is fun. I don't need to play anymore. I'm rich, but I got a Super Bowl title. I went to the Super Bowl, got two NFC championship rings. I don't need this.
Yeah, I kind of agree. He, like you said, he's one of the most unpredictable guys in the NFL. You never know what he's going to say, what he's going to do. So he is owed $7 million next year from the Seahawks, so I wouldn't be surprised if he took the last year of his contract and then maybe retired to see if he could get that championship again next year. You know, after losing this year, I think he still might want that championship. But Marshawn Lynch, completely unpredictable. No one has any idea what he's going to do. Only time will tell.
We shall see. I mean, Barry Sanders, I mean, he stopped playing at an early age, and that might have cost him, you know, a lot in the record books. So who knows if Marshawn Lynch will potentially, you know, make that same mistake. He's only 29 years old, so only time will tell. But listen, guys, that's all that we have for today's show. I'm your host again, Mark Thompson. And if you want to watch more of In the Zone, you can check us out at MUTV99.com. It's been real, Millersville.